Hello everyone, I am Daniel Santos from the CARLA team at Barcelona, and I'm going to talk about the External Sensor Interface, a project in which we are developing the new generation of electromagnetic sensor simulation. First, I will start with an introduction to our goals in this project, then I will make a brief overview of the general structure of the ESI, and finally I will explain two of its main components, the path tracing engine and everything related to the model of the environment. As you probably all know, in CARLA there is already implementations both of LiDAR and radar. In both of them, the output of the sensor is constructed via ray casting from the same configuration. Here, we want to go a step further and make a physically accurate simulation of the sensors. For this, we need to simulate their active nature. They have emitters that generate a signal and receivers that get the output. In the process, we need to take care of all the propagation of the radiation in the scene and, of course, the interaction of the electromagnetic radiation with all the environment. This is done in a completely new engine. In this way we can decouple from Unreal's pipeline and have complete control of the hardware that the users can provide us. Also, it opens the possibility of having a stand simulator, completely independent from CARLA. Although the external sensor interface is designed to work across the whole electromagnetic spectrum, the two ranges of frequency in which we are more interested are the ones corresponding to LiDAR and radar sensors. This is around 1 micron for LiDAR and a few millimeters for radar. Those are very different parts of the electromagnetic spectrum, and therefore the kind of physics phenomena that we need to take into account is very diverse. Example of this physics phenomena includes the reflection-refraction Fresnel effect. As we can see in the left picture, when a radiation, in this case visible light from the sun, strikes in a surface or a separation between two media, it reflects transmitting some specific wave, depending on the surface property and also in the incident angle. Another important phenomenon is the absorption that happens when a radiation strikes on a surface. Like for example, in the stealth aircraft that we can see on the right, one of its design decisions that make this plane invisible to radar is the choice of radar absorbent material for its skin. Also very important is the correct simulation of scattering of radiation in participating media. LiDAR frequencies are very sensitive to this kind of phenomena, so for having a correct simulation of the LiDAR sensor in foggy and rain condition, it will be crucial to take care of this. In the case of radar, we need to consider more advanced phenomena, like for example diffraction. This effect can make visible for this sensor even objects outside of field of view. Also, it's going to be very important to consider the interaction with surfaces can modify the radiation properties themselves. For example, due to the Doppler effect, the frequency of the electromagnetic wave can be modified, and then we can use this shift to compute the relative velocity between the sensor and other objects. In summary, we can find two different categories of physical phenomena. In the geometrical optics regime, we consider our electromagnetic radiation as a set of rays. Apart from the reflection, refraction, Fresnel effects and absorptions, we need to consider all the multiple advances that the ray can make before coming back to the detector. Also, the volumetric interaction are going to be crucial because, as we can see in this plot, in this case of aerosols in the atmosphere, we are going to have very different kind of scatterings like Mie and Rayleigh, depending on the sensor wavelength and also in the aerosol particle size. When the ray approximation is not enough, we need to consider the physical optics phenomena, in which the wave nature of the electromagnetic radiation needs to be considered, and a more fundamental approach is needed. This corresponds to phenomena like the already mentioned diffraction and Doppler effect. Let's talk a bit about the external sensor interface structure. Here, we can see a simplified image of the general structure of the ESI, with its main three components. In the scene module, we can manage all the actors in our scene, cars, pedestrians, buildings, and the relations between them. In the sensor module, we can configure all the sensors and attach them to actors in our scene. In ESI, we will have the possibility of including the most common commercial sensors available that are already defined inside the ESI, or define custom ones very easily. Finally, all the previews is taken by the physics engine that performs the physical simulation and compute the signal that all the sensors generate. As we commented in the previous slide, we can define our own sensor. It can be done using a simple configuration file in which we can specify all its important features. For example, the number of receivers and emitters and the geometry of them. And also, these emitters generate an electromagnetic wave that we need to model. In this case, we can also easily specify all of the important features like the wave shape or the wavelength. From this, we can generate our electromagnetic wave object that can be sampled into arrays when needed. In this slide, we can see two different examples of two configurations. The upper one, we have a 2x2 emitter grid, and in the bottom one, we have a 5 emitter in a cross configuration. In both of them, there are around 450 arrays per emitter. In a more complete picture, here we can see the general structure of the ESI. For example, the already explained model for sensors and actors. The physics engine is an interface that can be implemented in different ways, developed without losing compatibility with the rest of the ESI. For example, the first implementation that we are developing is a path tracing engine that we will explain in the next session. Apart from that, we have an input-output updater that is the responsible to manage all the communication with the outside. For example, to get all the information to instantiate all the rest of the modules and to deal with the output with the sensor's output. In this sense, the user can manually manage all of this communication or could be done through a bridge to Carla. Just a few notes about that. The external sensor interface is designed with a multi-threading architecture, or the physics simulation data processing and information updates run concurrently to allow synchronous and asynchronous mode and also to take advantage of the resources of the user. It is designed with a flexibility philosophy in mind. We want to make it as configured as possible, like the sensor module that we have described. To maximize performance in desktop or cluster machines, it is compatible with multiple GPU in which different sensors can be run in different GPUs. Now I'm going to talk about the path tracing engine, the first implementation of the physics engine. Let's describe the path tracing algorithm in a very simplified way. As we saw in the previous section, in the emitter we generate a set of rays that we trace here until we reach some geometry. There we sample the physical interaction, generating more rays if needed, until we reach some receiver. During the trace, we keep all the interaction of the rays during the path, and from there we can compute the ray contribution to the receiver response. Of course, this is not the full picture, and if we have participating media, we need to sample also the scattering in all the points in space, and then we add this contribution to the receiver response. Why do we use a path tracing approach? This method is very suitable for simulating all the geometrical optics phenomena, because of the use of the individual rays to compute physical interactions. Although the incorporation of wave phenomena is not straightforward, it can be done through extensions of this algorithm. Another argument to use this method is that it works very well with complex geometry like the ones that we find in our cities, like cars, buildings and pedestrians. And thanks in part to the development of the RTX technology by NVIDIA, this can be done fast using GPUs. For this reason, we have built our engine on top of the NVIDIA Optics library that gives us a robust and powerful framework and also allows us full control of the GPU through CUDA interoperability. Now, let's talk about the environmental modeling. The key missing aspect of the previous section was how exactly we can model the physical interaction that we are interested in. Of course, this is going to be crucial for having a realistic simulation. The main philosophy on our approach to this problem is having a unified representation for the physical properties that take into account all the different materials and media across all the electromagnetic spectrum, taking special attention in the LIDAR and radar frequency ranges. For this, we want to consider the minimal number of input parameters as possible, without losing any important physics. This is going to be important due to the scarcity of measurement of physical properties outside of the visible range. For this, We also want to be intuitive and physically relevant. Last, we need to take into account that our model needs to be able to deal with surface and volumetric interactions. So, how we describe our electromagnetic interaction with actors? Every actor has a geometry associated and then some physical properties, volumetric and superficial, defined in different electromagnetic ranges. So, let's talk about how we define the electromagnetic interaction first in volumes. For doing this, we have two important aspects to consider. The first one is the absorption coefficient, that is basically the energy absorption in the media per unit length. The most important object is going to be the volumetric scattering function, that is a distribution function that describes at each point of space the probability of being scattered in another direction. As we can see here, if we enter right, this is grain rate is the input rate, and at some point can scatter in all the purple directions. In general, we let the user to define its own volumetric scattering functions, but by default we use the Hewitt-Greenstein phase function. This is very used in very different fields, like from astrophysics to graphics, and it can be very easily parameterized with just one value, this g, that can take values between -1 and 1. Here we see that values of g close to 1 can give us a scattering in the forward direction. Most of the scattering is happening in the forward direction, and if we reduce this value, this is less and less true. If we consider g equals 0, we have isotropic scattering across all directions, and for negative values of g, we have scattering mostly in the backwards direction. Now, let's see how we do the environmental modeling for surfaces. For this, we base in the physically based shading models. They are broadly used in the field among game industries, but in our case, we have some differences. For a start, we want to take these models and extend it to the whole electromagnetic spectrum, and for that, we are going to keep it as simple as possible without losing physical important properties, and also, instead of maybe using, we are going to replace some artistic variables to some more physical intuitive ones. In general, our main object is the bidirectional scattering function, that similar to the one in the volumetric one, explain the probability for an incident ray to be scattered in any direction. Of course, in this case it's a bit more complex because we need to take in account the geometry between the incident ray and the surface. And in general, we divide this in four different BSDFs. We have two different in the same side of the incident ray. This is the reflective ones. The red one is the equivalent to a specular behavior, like in a mirror. And then we have a diffuse one that is like an isotropic one. Then we have two in the transmitted side that equivalently we have a refractive node and also a diffusive one. In this sense, in a general model, we are going to have these kind of parameters. We are going to have two physical ones, the index of refraction and the absorption coefficient, and then we have all the energy proportion both for the reflected and transmitted terms, a vector of general properties, a vector of material properties, and also the function that computes all the previous probabilities. Of course, this is a very general model that the user can tune as they like, but we want to be a bit more specific. For this, we propose a physically accurate minimal model in which you can define all the important physics only with four parameters. We are going to have here the two physical parameters that we described in the previous one, and all the energy distributions are computed based in physical laws. More specifically, in the Fresnel equations, and also for the surface, we model it with a microfacet model. For this, it's only We can do that only using two parameters for describe the material surface, that is the roughness and the metallicity. With this, our minimal model is one that consists only in six parameters, and with this we can define all the volumetric and surface properties based in physical interactions. One thing that we need to take in account is that all of these parameters that we have defined depends strongly in the wavelength on the radiation, and we need to take in account. For this, we allow to define these parameters in a general way, but we consider that this is difficult and probably not useful generally, on a piecewise definition that can be tuned for specific ranges of the sensors needed. Apart from this, we need to talk about another important aspect. For some specific cases, it will be very useful to define interfaces to input physical properties in a more physically intuitive way. For example, in the radar community, a very well used object is the radar cross section. So we'll allow to define our model using this observable. Also, speaking about the radar, we need to consider that for having a correct simulation, including all the wave phenomena that we need, we will need to extend our simulation with methods like the shooting and bouncing rays, in which we fine-grain our simulation and replace our usual ray intensity with more fundamental variables like the electromagnetic fields and currents. This is just to give a glimpse of our flexible philosophy. We want to allow the ESI to have the possibility of being easily extended with key contributions. So, just a bit summary, the external sensor interface is a new simulator engine in which we want to have a correct, physically accurate simulation of electromagnetic sensors. This is going to be external to Carla, and this will allow the possibility of being used with it or in a standalone application. Our main goal is to have a physically accurate simulation that incorporates all the relevant physical phenomena, and for that we have developed a unified environmental modeling that takes into account all the important physical properties across the whole electromagnetic spectrum. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope it was useful. Goodbye.